Hello everyone at EuroScientist. This is Technoculture. I am Federica Bressan and today I'm here with Andrea Glorioso, Policy Officer of the European Commission and responsible for the Future of Work dossier at DG Connect. Andrea was my guest on episode number 31 of this podcast. Welcome Andrea, it's nice to see you back.
It's a pleasure to be here.
During our interview, we tried to answer the question, what if robots steal our jobs? What are possible future scenarios of the impact of digital technology in its broad meaning on society and on ourselves? But we have not really explored a different possible scenario where we are not really concerned with replacing jobs. If a machine does something for me, I need to find something else to do. What if we could just work less? What about that scenario? Is it discussed in the European Commission, or you have your own opinion about it?
It is a scenario that is discussed not only the European Commission, but in many settings in which the impact of digitalization and robotization on labor markets and social systems are addressed. I think it's fair to say that if you look historically the impact of technology on our societies and specifically on the impact of technological change on labor relations, the trend tends to be one of a diminishing number of hours that are worked. That has been true in the passage during the first industrial revolution, the second industrial revolution. I'm not going much back in time, but you can make further considerations, similar considerations, even if you go back in time. I think it's very difficult to predict exactly how many hours less we would work on aggregate. Also because the number of hours that people work is the result of many different factors of which technology or the structure, if you want to use Marxian terms, is one of the elements. And in fact, in our societies in Europe, much of what are the conditions of work are in fact defined by regulation. It's law that defines the maximum number of hours that a worker, at least a unionized worker, can or cannot work. And there are actually quite stiff penalties if, as an employer, I directly or indirectly oblige a worker to work more. For me, what is more interesting and also more relevant is not so much the question, are we going to work less hours, more hours, all of us, etc., but how the nature of work is changing in the sense that with relatively standardized production processes, post-World War II industrialization, it was relatively easy to predict, to produce this number of items, I need to work this number of hours. You would optimize that process, and there are all kinds of techniques, not always in a human respectful fashion, by the way, but from a purely theoretical point of view, an analytical point of view, you could optimize that process, but you could make a sensible prediction of how much time would it take to produce something. But as our societies, I'm thinking especially of Europe and the US, are moving more and more towards services rather than manufacturing, and even in manufacturing and certainly services towards a push towards creative tasks. How can you predict in advance how long will it take you to have a good idea? You just cannot do that. And by the way, this is also something on which machines can help, can support, they already do. But at least with the current state and predictable state of technology, machines cannot have ideas by themselves. And so what I'm more interested in, and to be fair, what much of the research is also looking at, and it's a point that also has significant policy and regulatory implications, is if it is true that we are seeing the shift from more standardized ways of producing things, physical things, towards an economy that more and more focuses on services and on creative activities, what does that mean in terms of working conditions? We can have a debate whether you can stay for 7 or 8 or 10 hours or 4 hours in a factory to produce something. And there have been debates about that, and I'm not going to reopen those. But nobody really thinks, or very few people actually think what it means to be trying for 8 hours to create something, an idea. Because most people have this concept that, oh, you know, he's doing abstract things, it's so easy. Well, it's actually very intense. It's a very intense activity. It can create, actually, on average, more stress, creative activities, creative tasks can produce way more stress and pressure than simply building something, putting something together. Why is that important? First of all, because, as I said, it kind of changes the scope of the important questions that you put, because it's not so more, or it's not any more, or it's not as much the number of hours that you spend to do something, but it's the nature of the task and the impact on your well-being that particular task, creative in this case, produces. But also, most importantly, since given the current and predictable state of technology, that creativity, true creativity, will remain a human endeavor for a very long time. If people are concerned about the effects of automation in terms of stealing jobs, between quotes, well, then the answer should probably be, well, we should focus more on creative activities where the human element is still predominant. How do we support the development of skills and expertise in youngsters, in adults, that actually enables them to work on more creative activities? Because the reality is that a lot of school systems that we have today, certainly in my home country in Italy, but you know, we are not the only ones, it's true also elsewhere, they are still designed, they were created and they're still fundamentally designed to produce factory workers. They give you skills and expertise, which is excellent if you have to do very repetitive and clear tasks. They're not so great if your main focus in your work is about creating something. Skills which are very important in that setting, such as working in groups, empathy, communication, they're not taught that well in our current school systems. So there is one important policy and regulatory question: how do we adapt our school and education systems, formal and informal education? You know, it's also important to think about the people who are already working and they might want to change their jobs, or they need to adapt to new types of jobs or new tasks within jobs, more creative tasks.
Agreeing with what you just said, practically speaking, what about the revenue produced by the machines? Now, a truck driver is out of business because the truck drives itself. So the truck driver is supposed to look for another job, less hours, same hours, different type of job. But what about the revenue produced now by the machine that was before produced by the person? On a large scale, that may create a movement of capitals. Is there any future scenario, even utopian, that the European Commission or anyone is considering where systematically that can be repurposed to support the new occupations and people?
I must say, normally in the European Commission, we don't deal with utopias. We deal with, and I'm not discounting your question, because it is important to think about all the possible scenarios, including utopian or dystopian ones. There are parts of the European Commission which deal more with, they're usually called foresight studies. Let's be honest, however, in the day-to-day or even midterm political debate, there are sometimes less, or more often, I would say, there are more practical concerns. I think that the way that I interpret your question, which again, to be clear, it is an important question, is to look more at the issue of redistribution of value. Because as you point out, the amount of value that is produced by labor as opposed to the amount of value that is produced by capital, machine in this case, can shift, can change. Now, I think we also need to be clear that what we are seeing at the moment and what we predict for the foreseeable future, I'm thinking about 5 to 10 to 15 years time frame, we don't see, or at least I don't see, but it's also reflected in the studies that I've participated into, some others that I've seen, we don't see such a massive replacement of labor with capital in terms of revenue generation. I think we also need to be quite realistic and perhaps in the collective debate more honest than we have been so far, intellectually honest, in recognizing that technology, including artificial intelligence, automation technologies, are way less efficient and performant than people think. So a scenario in which entire sectors or entire industries would see this massive replacement of labor by capital in the form of automated machines, it's probably not going to happen. However, there are going to be changes. There are already changes, which are usually more localized. That doesn't mean that they're painless for the truck driver or for others. There are at least two issues through which one can look at the problem that you raise or the question that you raise. One, as I said, is the issue of redistribution. And that has to do about who captured the value that is produced by labor or capital. And how is that value redistributed? And usually we have, historically, we have done that, or at least after World War II, we have done it through tax policy and the welfare system in Europe. We collect taxes from productive activities, and then we redistribute the revenues coming from the taxes through different activities. In Europe, we have taken a decision to have a relatively high taxation, but also relatively generous welfare systems. Part of this redistribution should, in my personal view, should also go towards helping those that in localized settings or in specific industries are already or will undergo difficult transitions because of an increase in the use of capital, machines, in this case, the example of the truck driver that you gave. But again, if I may, we are not seeing a fleet of automated trucks going around Europe or in the US, where, by the way, in the US it's even much simpler because they have a lot more space to go around. And similarly, if we think about automated driving, self-driving cars, which is the other big example that is given, it's quite telling that the same people that 4 or 5 years ago were predicting entire cities full of self-driving cars in the next 10 years are not talking about the next 20 or 30 years, that maybe in 20, 30 years we will see this kind of technology. So technological change is happening. It is having effects like the ones you mentioned. But as I said, we also need to be a bit prudent in predicting entirely disruptive effects of these changes. The other lens, I said that one can look at these things at least through two lenses. One is the redistribution angle. The other is, again, and this is not an easy debate, it's the point that I was making before about the kind of skills and expertise that we need. Now, I would not necessarily, it's the usual example that is given. You take a worker who has been working in quote-unquote traditional industries, and then you ask, how can that person be creative? How can that person be... In my experience, a lot of people who work in sectors that we would normally consider to be traditional, very repetitive, they can be very creative. They are very creative. They simply work in a setting in which creativity is not rewarded. So if your job is to drive a truck from point A to point B, why would you be creative? That's your job. Quite frankly, even I, as a commission official, yes, we are rewarded for a little bit more creativity, but it's not like being very artistic in our in the expression of our ideas is rewarded in the place of work. So the question is, in my view, not so much are people creative or not, or are certain categories of people more creative or not. I believe, and I think that at least some branch of psychological and sociological research shows that all human beings are creative. All of us, we are creative. Some more, some less. Some are very good at doing that. Some a little bit less. Some have had the opportunity to nurture that creativity or those creative skills, some less. The question is the nature of our jobs changing in such a way that being creative is better than not being creative? And you can already see that in many sectors in which the real added value in certain jobs is being creative, coming up with new ideas, being able to work with others to deliver those ideas. The term innovation is used a lot and sometimes, quite frankly, not very correctly. But innovation ultimately is about having new ideas and being able to turn those ideas into concrete products or services that did not exist before, or better ways to use products and services that did not exist before. Innovation is something that you can find everywhere. So again, the question for me is not so much, if you will, the utopian question of what we're going to do with all the free time that might be available to us once the machine starts to perform more of human tasks. Maybe that will happen, maybe not. In some form, it's already happening. To me, the more urgent question is, as machines become more and more embedded into our way of living, how can we make sure that we don't simply shift from one non-creative job to another non-creative job, which is just basically pushing buttons on a keyboard rather than doing the same with analogic devices, but how we can use that opportunity to really focus on more creative tasks and endeavors, which, again, to be clear, I think is within reach of every human being. I never work with anybody, and I never met anybody from all walks of life and in any kind of job that, given the proper conditions, could not come up with creative ideas.
Can you give a comment to the audience of your scientist made of researchers and professionals in the field of science? What kind of concerns, if any, should they have in approaching the future?
Well, that's a very complicated question, and I'm not sure I can give an answer that is valid for everybody, but...
I mean, machines will never replace this.
Yes, indeed, and they will never replace what is truly the added value of human beings in research. What I would suggest to somebody who works in research, and I used to do it as well, by the way, before joining the commission, and to some extent even within the commission we do research, because when you have to provide analysis and recommendations, one would hope that those analyses and those recommendations that we as policy officers provide is based at least in some part on underlying research. So at least we need to have the ability to understand the research that is conducted in the particular field that we deal with. I think a couple of, if I may use the term, recommendations that I could give or suggestions is one, don't be scared by technological change, because I think that for the professional researchers, there are huge opportunities that the widespread use of information communication technologies and automatic analysis tools and all this stuff can bring. I mean, I remember when I did my research for my master's in sociology, which was more than 20 years ago by now, if I think about what I could have done with the technology that is now readily available for, €200, €300, the same technology back at the time, which would allow me to gather more data, analyze the data more quickly, visualize the data better, that same technology back at the time would have costed 20, 30, 40,000 euros. So it was completely out of budget for a would-be researcher. So there is that opportunity. I think researchers and anybody who works in research, and this is perhaps a bit of a broader issue, but it's certainly clearly linked with the widespread use of technology in society at large, also has a significant responsibility. I think that the research environment and researchers have a double responsibility to, a triple maybe responsibility, to understand the technologies that we're talking about. And that is not only for engineers, for computer scientists, it's for everybody, including philosophers, social scientists, economists, to truly understand what these technologies are capable of and are not capable of. And that leads to a second responsibility, which is to tell the right story to people. Because quite often, not always, but more often than should be the case, I see, honestly, research being put out, which... maybe because it doesn't explain properly the assumptions that are made in the research, maybe because it doesn't use the right term, but in any case, it's telling a story about the way in which the positive and negative effects of technology, which just does not reflect reality. I'm not implying any bad faith by any researcher, because the world of research has internal rules to ensure intellectual honesty, etc., and with few exceptions, those systems, those internal rules work. But I think, and this is the third responsibility, and it's closely linked to the second, I really think as policy officer of the Commission, as somebody who interacts with the research world quite a lot, I think the research world has to understand that when we look at the world of information communication technologies, including artificial intelligence, this is not anymore, if I may put it this way, a nerdy, geeky subject that very few people are interested about, and that is not really, people don't really see the impact of. This has become so central in our lives, which means that there is a political dimension to anything that the research world puts out. Let me try to put it this more bluntly. Researchers have to understand that whatever they write or say will be used politically. That does not mean that they should not put it out, they should not do research, that they should falsify the results of the research. That is absolutely not what I'm saying. But I do feel that researchers need to pay particular attention to understand that if there are assumptions to the result of a particular study, for example, on how many jobs are potentially going to get lost because of automation, those assumptions cannot be a footnote in the research. They have to be brought very much on the fore, because otherwise the political debate about, continue that example, will completely forget about the assumptions and will only focus on these very terrifying numbers about the number of jobs that are being lost. And again, as long as you're talking about, I say this with all due respect to the scientists that deal with that, as long as you talk about quantum entanglement, as important as it might be, it's not discussed in the, you know, in the European councils that we have here, in the evening newsroom, etc. The impact of ICT and automation on society and the world of work has become a very central topic. So researchers, the research world, I feel, has to adapt, has to update its practices, and has to understand. Many do, by the way, to be fair, many do. But more researchers have to understand what is the political value and what is the political impact of the research they conduct.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you for having me in the commission today, and keep up the good work.
Thank you very much.